Friends, welcome back. I'm going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 14th of May 2021. All right. And these lectures are basically based on the daily current affairs. Right. For that purpose, you should also study the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express. Right. Whichever it suits you, you can read any of these newspapers. Right. And we are also referring Hindu or Indian Express, both of these newspapers in our lectures. So you can subscribe our lectures on the YouTube also. Right. Which where, you know, we are uploading these lectures right on the day to day basis. So it will be, you know, helpful for your preparation also. Right. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first about the road accidents. As you know that there are a lot of fatalities related to the road accidents which are happens on the roads, right, due to the collisions, due to the some mishaps or accidents, right? So a lot of people, lakhs of the people died every year due to the road accidents, right? So what is happening is that the issue related to the compensation which have to be paid, right? While a victim, right, happens to be self-employed, or the victim happens to be, you know, the personal who are drawing the regular salary, right? So for that purpose, the Supreme Court has basically examined, right, the issue, right, that the Supreme Court recently held that an extra 40%, an extra 40% should be paid, right, as a compensation, right, for those person who have died in the road accident, right, as a victim, right, and whose age is below 40 years. The person happens to be the self-employed while calculating a compensation. That means an extra 40% should be paid to the victim who are supposed to be the self-employed and who died due to the road accidents, while giving the compensation to the victim. Okay, this judgment or this direction have been passed down by the our Supreme Court of India, right, which is the three judge bench, which is led by Chief Justice N.V. Ramana, who has recently said that this additional 40% should be paid, and it should be, you know, included in the income of the dead person as a future prospect, as a part of the compensation that would be paid to the person who have recently died. So what happens is, I am just going to tell you the two cases that are most important cases. Our Honorable Chief Justice of India N.V. Ramana also referred these two cases in basically while delivering this judgment. The first case was basically happened, that is called the National Insurance Company, that is basically, you know, been here also mentioned, right? So here the Chief Justice of India referred the constitutional bench decisions in the National Insurance Company versus Pranay Sethi. This is the first case that was dealt by the Supreme Court of India. Okay, after, you know, a one case that was also the most important, that is the Sarla Devi versus Delhi Transport Corporation, DTC, right? So first I'm just going to tell you this case, that is Sarla Devi versus Delhi Transport Corporation, and then we'll move to the National Insurance versus the Pranay Sethi, right? So what happens is, you know, the five judge bench that is basically held the decision during that point of the time when the National Insurance versus Pranay Sethi, you know, the case which basically came before the Supreme Court judge bench, right, it has laid down certain guidelines, right, and this guideline provided some sort of a fixation of the future prospect in case of the motor accidents of the victims. Okay, and that victims happens to be the permanently employed, right, which are receiving some fixed salary, or self-employed, whatever may be. So some guidelines have been fixed by this five judge bench in the basically National Insurance Company Limited versus Pranay Sethi case, right? Now, after analyzing the decision that was taken, you know, during this Sarla Devi versus DTC or Delhi Transport Corporation, the court basically concerned, you know, with the view that the standardization of this addition to that income, right, that is basically being added, right, towards this future prospect, right, that in the previous phase I was discussing about, in accordance with the Motor Vehicle Act 1988, because the compensation will be paid under Motor Vehicle Act 1988, which is the main statutory provision which lies in, you know, in the Indian context. So it is observed that just compensation has to be determined on the foundation of the fairness, the reasonableness and equitability, right? So that compensation should be based on this fairness, reasonableness, and equitability, and that should be definitely, you know, determine, you know, some sort of a compensation that will be paid. So the bench basically in the National Insurance Company versus the Pranay Sethi have clarified that in case of disease, the person is happens to be the self-employed and who is happens to be the, you know, below to 40 years of the age, 40% of the additional amount would be paid to their income as a future prospect, right? Because such person had recently died, right? And High Court had earlier held the victim ineligible for the future prospect because of she was self-employed. I was talking about this Sarla Devi versus DTC. So in that case, the High Court of Delhi basically that has basically, you know, declared that the Sarla Devi, you know, was ineligible for the future prospect because she was self-employed and not, you know, permanently employed or, you know, something like which is receiving the fixed salary, right? So that is something was important. And in that, the Sarla Devi versus DTC judgment was basically, you know, have been changed or have been overturned by the Supreme Court of India 5-judge bench, that is National Insurance Company versus Pranay Sethi. And here it has been clarified that the person happens to be the self-employed will also be eligible to get this additional 40% of the compensation, right? If the person happens to be, you know, dead in the road accident as a future prospect. That is the most important aspect you must understand with respect to these two cases. Okay. Next, the Indu Jain. The Indu Jain was basically, you know, she was the chairperson of the Times Group. Okay, the Times Group, the Times of India, right, which is the leading newspaper you might have seen or you might have studied also. Right, she was basically the chairperson of the Times Group and she recently died due to the COVID complications and she was 84 years of the age. Miss Indu Jain was born in 1936 and she died in 2021. She was 84 years old and she died due to the coronavirus. And you know, she was very prominent intermedia personality, right? And she basically belongs to the Sahu Jain family, right? And she was also the chairperson of the largest media group, that is the Bennett Coleman and Company Limited, which is also popularly known as the Times Group, right? Which is also the leading newspaper in India. Okay. So regarding Bennett Coleman Company Limited, as I told you that it is also known as the Times Group, right? It is basically, you know, the Indian media conglomerate, which is headquartered in Mumbai, Maharashtra. Okay. So the company remains fully owned business with the Sahu, you know, a Jain family owning the majority stake basically in this Times Group. Okay. Next, she was the chairperson of this Bharatiya Gyanpeet Trust. So what is this Bharatiya Gyanpeet? See, Bharatiya Gyanpeet basically is a literary and the research organization. Okay. And which is based in New Delhi. And it was founded, you know, in 1944 way back by the Sahu Shanti Prasad Jain, right? The Sahu Shanti Prasad Jain was basically belonged to the Sahu Jain family, the same family which, you know, the Indu Sahu was basically belong, right? And it was this Bharatiya Janapeeth basically was founded by Sahu Shanti Prasad Jain to undertake systematic research and the publications related to the Pali, Prakrit, Sanskrit, and, you know, different other languages, right? And different other subjects like religion, philosophy, logic, ethics, grammar, astrology, politics, and etc. Okay, so you know, the present highest, you know, literary award, that is the Jnanpith award, was also been presented by the Bharatiya Jnanpith Trust, and it is the prestigious, you know, the literary award in India. Okay, and Indu Jain was also awarded the Padma Bhushan by the government of India in 2016 also. Okay, she was Indu Jain. She was recently died at the age of 84 due to the COVID related complications. All right. Next, the indicative notes. See, indicative notes is basically a new feature with the Supreme Court of India, right? You can see this indicative notes on the website of the Supreme Court of India, which is a recent initiative which was launched by the Supreme Court of India, or you can say the Chief Justice of India, N.B. Ramana, have launched this new initiative called indicative notes. Now, what is that and what is the significance of the indicative notes? These indicative notes are basically short notes. You can say that just like a normal, you know, the short notes we have. Right. So these notes are nothing but, you know, the summaries of the landmark judgments, whatever. For example, you can say you know, the Keshavanand Bharati judgment that came in 24th of April 1973. So that indicative note related to the Keshavanand Bharati may be there on the website of the Supreme Court, right? Which basically provides you that the Keshavanand Bharati judgment have brought the doctrine of the, you know, the basic structure of the Constitution. So that is the indicative judgment in front. That means, or in fact, it is basically the concise summaries of the landmark judgments. The Keshavanand Bharati is also landmark judgment, right? In that sense. Okay. So like that, there are a lot of landmark judgments, right? So these landmark judgments would be having the summaries, right? And these summaries would be put on the website of the Supreme Court, right? Which is in easy to understandable format, right? So that, you know, the research purpose, the media persons, the general public can basically access those landmark judgments with the help of these indicative notes or with the help of these concise summaries related to those judgments, which can be easily understandable by the common people, right? As you know, it is the most important aspect. Okay, next is Sovereign Gold Bond Scheme 2021-22. Okay, so first of all, let us understand what is this Sovereign Gold Bond Scheme, right? So first of all, you must understand the Sovereign Gold Bond Scheme was basically, you know, it was, you know, the government securities denominated in terms of the grams of the gold, okay, and they are basically the substitutes of the holding of the physical gold. So in terms of that, you can basically hold the government securities, but which are denominated in terms of the grams of the gold. The investors, right, like the common people, they have to pay the issue price, right, in cash, and the bonds will be redeemed in cash on the maturity, right? And the bonds are issued by the Reserve Bank of India on behalf of the government of India. I'm talking in terms of sovereign gold bond, right? And what are the benefits of having this sovereign gold bond? So you could think that the quantity of the gold for which, you know, the investors pay, that is protected, right? And the investor is receiving, you know, the ongoing market price at the time of the redemption or the premature redemption also. So this sovereign gold bond basically offers, you know, some sort of a superior alternative to the holding of this gold in the physical form. So instead of that one, you could hold this government securities in the form of the sovereign gold bond, and the risk and the cost for the storage are also eliminated, because you have to purchase a locker with the government of with the scheduled bank, and you have to pay some money, right? It will be some sort of a cost will be incurred for the storage purpose also, right? And there are associated risk also, so this risk and the cost also will be eliminated, and those investors are also assured of the market value of the gold at the time of their maturity, right? And those investors are also assured of the periodic interest also that will be provided, you know, to those investors. And this sovereign gold bond is free from issuing any sort of a, you know, making these charges, right, which are there in terms of the gold in the jewelry form, right? So this is all about the sovereign gold bond scheme. Now let us understand the news related to the central government. The central government has, you know, decided that central government, in consultation with the Reserve Bank of India, had decided to again issue the sovereign gold bond for the purpose of 2021-22. Okay, now this sovereign gold bond will be issued in the sixth tranches from the May 17th to the September 2021, right? Definitely by the Reserve Bank of India, okay, on behalf of the government of India. Okay, these bonds will be sold, as I told you, through scheduled commercial banks, right? Then Stock Holding Corporation of India Limited, the Design Post Offices, and recognized stock exchanges, like you can think of the National Stock Exchange of India Limited and the Bombay Stock Exchange Limited. Okay, and the small financial banks and payment banks are not eligible to sold those bonds, right, which are also known as the sovereign gold bond. Now what is this scheduled commercial bank which are eligible to sold this, you know, the sovereign gold bonds? So scheduled commercial banks are those banks which are included in the second schedule of the Reserve Bank of India Act 1934. So those banks which are included in this second schedule of Reserve Bank of India Act 1934 are called scheduled commercial banks. Okay, so that is. And what is this Stock Holding Corporation of India Limited? The Stock Holding Corporation of India Limited is a Indian custodian and depository participant, and it has been headquartered in Mumbai, Maharashtra. It was established in 1986, and it is basically a public limited company, and it is also responsible for e-stamping system around our country. around our country. Okay. And about the National Stock Exchange and Bombay Stock Exchange, you know all about. Okay. The basic difference I can tell you about the National Stock Exchange and the Bombay Stock Exchange, right? You could easily can get it out also, right? So the both National Stock Exchanges and the Bombay Stock Exchanges, both are basically, both are basically one of the top stock exchanges in our country. But in terms of their age, the Bombay Stock Exchange is the oldest stock exchange, okay? And the National Stock Exchange basically is the youngest stock exchange, okay? And when you say in terms of their prestige, so Bombay Stock Exchange in terms of the 10th position in the top stock exchanges in the world, the National Stock Exchange basically is at the 11th position, okay? And in terms of their setup, the electronic exchange system was first introduced by the NSE in 1992, right? And the Bombay Stock Exchange electronic system was existent since 1995. Right, and the NSE's index or National Stock Exchange index is Nifty 50, that you would have seen also through the newspapers, right, which gives the top 50 stock index, right? And the Bombay Stock Exchange index is Sensex, which is basically provide you the top 30 stock index. So NSE's index is Nifty 50, okay, that provides you the top 50 stock index, but BSE's or Bombay Stock Exchange index is Sensex, which gives you the 30 stock index. Okay, and the BSE was basically recognized as a stock exchange in 1957, but NSE was recognized in 1993. So in that sense, NSE is basically the youngest one, but BSE is basically the oldest in that sense. Okay, and you must also understand that the BSE basically Sensex comprises of the 30 companies, but NSE Nifty basically comprises of 50 companies. Okay, and the number of listed companies, if you see, the number of listed companies are much lesser with the NSE, that is around 1600 only. But number of listed companies with the BSE or Bombay Stock Exchange, that is much higher, that is around 5749 companies also. Okay, so this is something, I told you some of the basic differences between BSE and NSE. And NSEs, right? And regarding the sovereign gold bond scheme, the minimum permissible investment, that is 1 gram of the gold, the investor can basically invest in that, and investor will be compensated at a fixed rate of 2.5% per annum, that will be paid to the investor, right, on semi-annually basis on the nominal value of that gold. Okay, and the bond, right, who can purchase that bond, or the scheduled commercial banks or the stock holding companies, to whom they are eligible to sold that bond, right? So it can be sold to the resident individuals, Hindu undivided families, the trusts, universities, and the charitable institutions, right? Regarding tenure, right, the tenure for the bond is around 8 years, right? And that will have the exit option also after 5th year, so you can exit from the bond scheme also, right? And it will be exercised on the next interest payment dates also. Okay. Next, the house arrest. As you know that the occupancy rates of the jails, right, which basically house the inmates or the convicted peoples, right, who are basically convicted of different type of crimes. So these jails are basically overburdened, right? They don't have the capacity to have more inmates or more prisoners in the jails, right? So what is happening is that there is a debate that can we allow the house arrest of those persons instead of putting them into the jail, right? Because now COVID pandemic is also causing so much strain on the jail infrastructure, right? And the over occupancy have also led to the infection rate is also very high in those jails. So what is happening is that the Supreme Court has thrown open a discussion, right, on that house arrest, that allows basically the legislature to discuss, to ponder over the idea that instead of sending a person, you could basically put the person into the house arrest, right? So that would basically avoid the over congestion or overcrowding of the prisons. So this discussion was initiated by the judges UU Lalit, KM Joseph, right, in the Supreme Court itself, and that basically highlight the alarming stats of the courts, right, on the prisons, right? For example, the Chief Justice N.V. Ramanna basically you know, have given series of directions to various courts in the country that provide some sort of a interim bail or the parole to the prisoners so that we can decongest the prisons, right, from the present capacity. Okay, and Justice Joseph has also said that current occupancy rate in the prisons basically is 118.5%. That is the overburden, right, prison infrastructure. And the court basically referred the data from the National Crime Record Bureau, right. The data basically from 2019 shows that there are almost 18 lakh inmates that are there in the jails of India, right. And number of under trial prisoners in 2019, that is in 1 year, was, you know, that is in 2019 was 330,487. That is the under trial person, right? They are not convicted. Okay, and these under trial prisoners are basically consisting of majority of the sections of the prisoners. That is around 70%, you can say 69.05% of the total prisoners that are languishing in our jails, right? And the government of India as well as various state governments basically spend very large amount of money. That is around 6,818 crore of the rupees have been spent. So in terms of the budget, also is very high in terms of the number of the prisoners, which are also very high in terms of jails. So the tremendous overcrowding of those prisons and tremendous budget, right, which is also causing the most important aspect of opening of this, the avenues, right, like the house arrest of those persons instead of sending them to the jails. Okay, so has the court noted in that prospect. Okay, next is COVID shield. As you know that there are currently two, the vaccines related to the COVID-19 pandemic or the novel coronavirus, right? So these two vaccines are currently in India, right? Which are currently being administered to the citizens of our country. But now what is happening is that the COVID working group, which is being headed by Dr. N.K. Arora, have recently recommended that there should be, you know, the gap between the first and second dose of COVID shield, that should be increased to 12 to 16 weeks. So instead of 6 to 8 weeks, now this gap between first to second dose, that should be increased to 12 to 16 weeks. And government of India basically have accepted this recommendation of the COVID working group, which is chaired by Dr. N.K. Arora, right? And it was previously decided that the gap between two doses of the COVID shield, right, is 6 to 8 weeks only. But now it has been increased to, you know, 12 to 16 weeks, almost double, right? So this evidence or this being, you know, the suggestions or recommendations based on the real life evidence, which is particularly taken from the UK, United Kingdom, right, as well as several countries, which also show some sort of a, you know, the adverse implications on the health of the citizens, right, with regard to those, you know, the complications which arises out of giving this, you know, the vaccines related to the COVID-19, right? So this increasing of this interval to 12 to 6 weeks would definitely, you know, have some impact on the efficacy of the vaccines also. But this COVID working group has not recommended any changes in the schedule for the Covaxin. So the Covaxin vaccine would be provided as per the schedule which was previously decided. But for the purpose of COVID shield, the 12 to 16 weeks interval will be provided between the two doses of the vaccine that will be administered to the persons. Okay. This COVID working group, which is headed by N.K. Arora, which is the director with the Insulin Trust. What is this Insulin Trust? See, Insulin Trust is also known as the International Clinical Epidemiology Network. Okay, it is a full form for this Insulin Trust. Now, it is basically, you know, you can say it is basically a professional association, right? So Insulin is basically the unique international network of the healthcare professionals, specifically the clinical epidemiologists or biostatisticians, right, health social scientists and other health professionals, right, and who provide some sort of a multidisciplinary approaches to identify the best practices to improve the health for all, and at the local level, at the national level, at the regional level, at the global setting also. Right, so how the, you know, this Insulin Trust basically achieved this by using some sort of a network to conduct this collaborative interdisciplinary research on the health priority health problems, right, or high priority health problems, and to train the future generations of the leader specifically in the healthcare research, right? And the recommendations for this COVID working group was basically accepted by the government of India, right? Or the National Expert Group on the Vaccine Administration for the COVID-19, which is also headed by Dr. N.K. Paul. The Dr. N.K. Paul is also the member health, right, with the Niti Aayog, right, in its meeting on 12th of May 2021. So, which is the significant that government of India also accepted the recommendation which was provided by the COVID working group, right, which was headed by Dr. N.K. Arora. Okay, so it is basically the Covishield vaccine. Okay, next, the housing financing companies or HFCs. Now, what is happening is that, right, as you know that, you know, there are some issues related to, you know, the rates or home rates or the loans which are provided to the customers for the purpose of, building of their homes and something like that. So these loans are provided by the housing financing companies. So housing finance companies are basically, you know, another form of non-banking financing company. Their primary task is to engage in the business of providing finance to the housing. So the housing finance companies, which are coming direct supervision of the Reserve Bank of India, right, you know, have provided, you know, some sort of a, differential treatment, right, from the banks and, you know, housing financing companies. So the customers which are taking the loans from the banks and the housing finance companies, they have been treated somewhat differently in terms of their cuts in their home loan rates, right, over the period of the time. So that is basically, you know, the existing differential treatment still exists, right, from the banks and from these housing financing companies, right. For example, over 18 months to five years, right, the bank customers are having, you know, better transmission of the rate cuts, right, in terms of their home loans. For example, if I take the home loan from the bank, I would have the more, you know, the rate cuts in terms of, you know, repayment of those home loans, right, in terms of, you know, on the accounts of the cut in the marginal cost of lending rate, right. And but these housing financing companies, right, they have limited benefit because they face or they find very limited or very relatively small cuts in their prime lending rates. So because of this smaller cuts in the prime lending rates, the customers which are receiving their loans from these housing financing companies, they are having limited benefits, but there are high cuts or they are often cuts in the marginal cost of lending rate by the banks. So these customers which are receiving their finance from the banks, they are also having the better transmission of these rates or their rate cuts in terms of their home loans, right? So now let us understand first what is this marginal cost of lending rate and why the banks are, you know, able to transmit those rate cuts to their customers, right, in terms of the cut in their home loan rates. So this marginal cost of fund based lending rate is a minimum interest rate at the bank can lend, right? So you can say this MCLR or marginal cost of fund based lending rate is a tenor linked internal benchmark, right, which means you can say that the rate is determined internally by the bank itself, and it depends on the period that is left for the repayment of the loan, right? So that is something you must understand, that marginal cost of funds based the lending rate is the minimum lending rate below which the bank is not permitted to lend, and it is determined internally by the bank itself, right? And regarding this prime lending rate, right, that is also known as PLR. So the Reserve Bank of India introduced this benchmark, you know, prime lending rate, right, in the financial year 2003-2004. Right, this prime lending rate is a rate on which the commercial banks or, you know, these housing finance companies basically tend to have their most, you know, lend to their most trustworthy and the creditworthy customers. So what happens is, this is something, you know, you must understand with respect to that. Okay. Now, these housing finance companies and the banks compete hard on the rates because whichever provide, you know, some sort of a lesser burden on the customers, right, the customers would be more attracted towards them. So the banks are more attractive because of they provide, you know, better cuts in their you know, home rates or the loan rates, right? And the cuts in the rates for the existing customers depend on the reduction in the MCLR, right, or the marginal cost of the fund based lending rate, or by the PLR by the HFCs, right, in which is in the response to the repo cut by the Reserve Bank of India. So you must understand that the rates on which the home loans will be provided to the customers are depend on the cut in the MCLR or the marginal cost of the fund based lending rate for the banks, and the cut in the lending rate or the cut in the basically home loans in terms of the new loans to the new customers by the housing finance companies depends on the cut in the prime, you know, prime lending rate. But that both marginal cost based, you know, funds based lending rate as well as your prime lending rate, both are dependent on the repo cut, which was determined by the RBI. So what is this repo rate? Repo rate is determined, you know, this prime lending rate. Currently, you must understand that all commercial banks have authority to set up their own benchmark, you know, prime lending rate, right? Which would think that, you know, that is basically crucial for the borrowers, right? That affecting the lending rates for the home loans also. Okay, this repo rate was talking is interest rate at which the central bank means Reserve Bank of India, right, of our country, right, lends money to the commercial banks, right. So the central bank or Reserve Bank of India in India, right, uses this repo rate to regulate the liquidity in the economy. Liquidity means the amount of money supply in the economy. So in banking, the repo rate is related to the repurchase options or repurchase agreement, right, from the banks or, you know, something like that. So that is the repo rate. Repo rate means interest rate at which the central bank or Reserve Bank of India lends money to the commercial banks. So it's a mechanism to control, you know, the liquidity in the economy. So this housing finance companies base their lending rate on the prime lending rate, which offers a discount on it to the customers. Now one thing you must understand that, you know, that how would this basically affect. So you could say that this prime lending rate is basically a primary determiner of most of the interest rate charged by the lending institutions, right? It is the most important components, you know, of the rate charged to the customer. Interest rates are basically, you know, compensation the banks get, you know, against the risk taken by the banks and which are based on the credit history of the borrower, right? You could say that the interest rate which provide cover against the cost of these housing finance companies to incur the lending, including their cost of default and etc., all such costs will be involved. And the prime factor which determine the interest rate, right, will basically the charge a prospective customer is basically a default risk. The credit worthy customer are the most trusted one, right, which is a little chance to default. As a result, the bank charge basically them a lower rate of interest because they are most credit worthy, they are lesser chance to default rather than those customers which are having higher chance of default risk, right? So that is also most important in that sense. So the discount is fixed in terms of their loan as a upward or downward revision of this prime lending rate in line with the repo rate movement, which impact the lending rate to the existing consumers also, right, from these housing financing companies. Okay, for the new customers, the housing financing companies can increase the discount on the PLR basis to offer the more attractive rate, just like I was explaining you. Okay, and this cuts in the PLR reflected in basically, you know, to the customers within 3 months or every 3 months. Okay, and the banks which basically cut all such lending rates, which is also based on this MCLR, right, which is also dependent on the repo rate, which was given by the RBI in that sense. Okay, next, the SWAMI. What is SWAMI? SWAMI is the special window for affordable and mid-income housing. So what is that? What is this special window for affordable and mid-income housing? Okay, now I will give you a brief background about it. Now you must understand, because of COVID and because of lot of problems in terms of the financing of those housing related products, housing related, you know, the infrastructure projects like affordable housing, right? So in order to give a relief to the home buyers, of the stalled projects, like various projects have been stalled. So to give the relief to the home buyers, a special window for the completion of affordable and mid-income housing, you know, the project was basically initiated by the government of India. So under this SWAMI scheme, you know, a fund have been created for funding the stalled projects that are the net worth positive, and that include, you know, those projects which have been declared as a non-performing assets, right? Or which are pending, you know, proceedings before the National Company Law Tribunal under Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code. So you must understand that those projects which are stalled due to some sort of a either problem because of the funding or because of the non-performing asset or because of the proceeding which initiated before the National Company Law Tribunal, those projects having the net positive worth would be provided the funding from such the Swami Investment Fund. So this Swami Investment Fund will be provide the last mile funding to the stressed, affordable and the middle income housing projects in our country. So I hope it will be clear to you. Now for that purpose, the Union Minister for the Finance and Corporate Affairs handed over the possession of the home buyers as the Government of India's special fund that is called Swami Fund, for specifically for the residential projects, for you know, for affordable and middle income housing projects in our country. So one such residential project that is called Rivali Park, which was located in suburb of Mumbai, it was the first housing project which was funded, right, under this Swami, the investment fund, right? And this Swami Investment Fund, which was launched in 2019, right, and under which the Rivali Park Winter Greens is the first investment by the fund, right, and that was also to get completed under this fund. So in the short span of the time, say 1.5 years, right, the Swami Investment Fund have you know, one of the largest private equity teams in our country, and which has done very, very commendable work despite of COVID-19 related restrictions, right. This fund or this Swami Investment Fund have given already final approval to 72 projects related to the funding, right? That basically completes around 44,100 homes. That is also most important for basically for the affordable housing for the middle income people, right? As well as 132 projects have received the preliminary approval, right? Once this would be completed, that will basically having, you know, complete in terms of 72,500 homes that will also additionally be provided under this funding, under this Swami Investment Fund. So this Swami Investment Fund is targeting to have, you know, the completion to the aggregate of around 116,600 homes in our country that will be funded under this Swami Investment Fund. And definitely this fund is bridging the trust deficit which is between the home buyers and the developers, right? As I told you that something which is the projects have been stalled and there is non-performing assets and right, a lot of issues like proceedings initiated before the National Company Law Tribunal. So these projects have got stuck. These projects have got stalled. Home buyers, their money have been stuck, right? The developers are unable to start projects, right? A lot of issues were there. So obviously there was trust deficit between the developers and the home buyers to, in order to relieve that one, in order to provide the most important aspect of, you know, the housing, affordable housing to the home buyers and to give a last chance to the developers, this Swami Investment Fund was basically initiated, and that delivers the homes without depending on any other source of the finance in our country. Okay. Next, the smokeless cremation. Now you must understand the smokeless cremation, that is in the backdrop of the COVID-19 deaths which are occurring in our country. Now you must understand the Indian Institute of Technology or IIT Roper, which is basically the most prestigious, technical institution in our country of the national importance, have developed a prototype of the electrical cremation system. You have seen the electrical cremation system, which did not provide or it does not give any sort of a smoke, right? So a prototype of a movable electrical cremation system have been developed by Indian Institute of Technology Roper. Okay, now the IIT Roper have claimed that it is the first of its kind technology which does not involve the smoke while cremation of the dead bodies. Okay, despite of using the wood, but wood that is being used in this prototype of the electrical cremation system is basically using almost half of the wood which basically used in the normal, the cremation procedure of the dead bodies. So it uses half of the wood otherwise which is required in the cremation of the dead bodies in the normal procedure. So it is also eco-friendly because the technology basically uses the combustion air system, right? And it's based on the wick stove technology, which has been, further developed by IIT Roper, right? In which the wick then when lighted glows yellow, right? It will show into your figure, in the figure, right, and it will be basically converted into smokeless blue flame with the help of this combustion air system, which is being installed over the bricks. And overall, the temperature is basically heated in the incinerator or the cremation system reaches up to 1044 degrees Celsius, right? This high temperature will ensure that a complete sterilization occur of the dead bodies, right? And in the backdrop of this pandemic, right, most people or most poor people who could not afford, you know, the burden of arranging this wood would be getting benefited out of this system, which is based on the wick stove technology and which basically uses almost half of the wood that is being needed in the normal cremation of the dead bodies. Okay, here you could see the real flame, right? One of the researchers at IIT Roper is basically conducting this experiment. Okay, next you have the Bhavani Devi. The Bhavani Devi, the full form of the Bhavani Devi is the Chandalavada Ananda Sundaraman Bhavani Devi, which is also famously known as, you know, simple Bhavani Devi. She was, you know, she was born in 1993 and she is basically the Indian saber or Indian fencer. So recently, the Indian fencer or Indian saber, Miss Bhavani Devi, has created a history by becoming the first Indian fencer to qualify for the Olympic Games, right? And she would be looking forward to give her best in the performance of those Olympic Games that is basically happened in, you know, in the Tokyo in 2020. Right, so that is the first such Indian fencer who qualified for the Olympic Games, and she was the first fencer to ever qualify for the Olympic Games after qualifying for 2021 Tokyo Games. Now you would be thinking, what is this fencing? Many of you would be hearing this fencing first time. What is this fencing? What is this saber? Right? What is this saber? What is this fencing? See, I'll give you a brief background about what is fencing. See, fencing is a common term that is basically we use for sword fighting, talwar fighting, sword fighting. Right? आपने देखा होगा तलवार, तलवार से लड़ते हैं ना? So that is also a game, right? So fencing is a common term that we basically use for the sword fighting. The two fighters, right? Individually, the two fighters or two persons, they basically carry the sword, right? You know, that the two fighters basically compete on the elevated pist, right? And which is also known as the strip or the playing area. So they would just come on this the playing area, or that is called elevated pist, and the strip is around 14 meter long, right, on which these two participants would basically there. So it is around 14 meter long, right, and the width is around 1.5 meter. So you could think of this much elevated pist is basically there, where the two participants or two fighters basically pick their sword and they start fighting, right? So there are three kinds of weapons, right, which are used in the fencing. The three kinds of weapons: first is epee, right, second is foil, and the third is basically your saber. So I'm talking about this third type of weapon or third kind of weapon, which is basically used in this fencing, which is basically a sport, or which is also known as the sword fighting. Now, what is this saber? We are basically concerning this third type of weapon. So saber basically is a weapon, or it's a simple sword that is 105 centimeter long, or its length is 1.5 centimeters, right? And the blade, right? The blade is 88 centimeters long. You could think of the total length of the sword. If you have seen, that is also having the handle, all sorts of things. And that is also having the blade. That blade means that is the cutting portion through which you can cut, right, the person. So that blade is having 88 centimeters long, and it is having the weight of around 500 grams only, or less than 500 grams only. So it is very, very light. The basic difference with the foil, you know, which is the second such type of, you know, the weapon, is that a hit can be made even with the cutting edge, right, and not only with the point. So you could think that the hit can be done by the cutting edge, right, as well as with the point. And the target area basically consisting of everything that is above the waist of a participant. So that is, you have to target the area above the waist, but not below the waist, right? For example, if the person happens to be like that, okay, now you have to cover this area above the waist. of a person, right? Not below the waist, right? It will also include, you know, your hands, your head, both arms, right? Everything will be covered, but above the waist. And it is also governed by the rules of the right of the way, right? And recently, Bhavani Devi competes the Sever event, right? Which is also the most important. And regarding this fencing, you must understand the fencing in India was started in the quite late, right? It was started in 1974 itself, okay? And it was started with the Fencing Association of India that was established, and it took for around next 23 years to be recognized by the government of India in 1997, right? So in 1997, government of India has recognized this sport, okay? And she was supported by the Jio Sport Foundation through Rahul Dravid Athlete Mentorship Program. And the Bhavani was born in the middle class family in Chennai, Tamil Nadu, right? All right, fine. So you could see she is Bhavani Devi. She was first woman to qualify in the Sever, fencing. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this session. Please take care of yourself, right? As the corona wave is, you know, the second wave of the corona is affecting almost all people. So be safe, be at home, right? And take care of yourself and your dependents. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.